Well, good morning. So great to see everyone here this morning as we come to worship the Lord. And this morning we get to wrap up our series in Job and see what the culmination is. And we get to see that he opens his eyes and sees the Lord. So that's what we'll be focusing on today. And it's sort of an Advent moment, if you will, where it's a now, not yet type thing, because we're going to see how our eyes can be opened to the Lord as well. So wanted to just remind everyone of that, and want to welcome everyone in, whether you're here in person or online. I'm Pastor Matt, if it's your first time watching along, and just encourage everyone online to be active and interactive. You guys can be saying hi as well, and sharing any prayer requests you have during service. So wanted to share that. Also wanted to share that the 2021 church directory is out today, so make sure to check your mailboxes. Got that all completed with all the updates, and I'm sure we'll find one as soon as it's out. It'll be like, oh, that's actually changed, but we did as much as we could, and so just be able to keep in touch with people by phone or email. It's a great tool, so make sure you go to your mailbox and get that. Also, we sent it out on Thursday, so if you did want that electronic copy, that should be to you. If you didn't get that, please let us know. And then wanted to share that next week at 10 a.m. we come together, and it's Reformation Sunday. And we're going to be celebrating the reforming work in the church, not specifically Martin Luther himself, because he wouldn't want us to put him at the center, but the reforming work of the gospel in our lives and how it can truly free us. So that'll be our focus, is be free indeed. And so that's what we'll be looking at next week at 10 a.m., so you can join us in person or online. And as you see the PS at the bottom there, wear red. So obviously that's sort of the seasonal thing to do with Reformation, so make sure you wear some red. I'm even going to make sure I wear my robe and my red stole, so we'll look really fancy and ready to go for Reformation. So wanted to share that, and then also wanted to share that Zoom Bible study continues this Wednesday. As we conclude Job, we'll be looking at what we're looking at today more in depth, so wanted to invite everyone to partake in that. We've had some good conversations, and it's just a time of blessing for us. And then wanted to share, and this is more just to put on your calendar, is talking with the council and thinking about logistics and planning various things. We decided to give everyone more time as we're going to move the voters meeting for the mostly budgetary purposes, but a few other things back to December 19th. So usually we have it in November, but I know last year we had an advisory vote that okayed us doing that, so drawing upon that and just scheduling stuff, we'll have it the third week of December, which is the 19th, after a 10 a.m. service. So it'll also be streamed as well, so if there's anyone who can't make it in person but wanted to share that, so you can mark it on your calendars early and know that's when it's going to be. And then finally, I wanted to share, there's a stewardship thought like we've been doing quite a bit of recently in your bulletin on the back page, speaking to Job 42, and the reminder of what true blessing looks like. And it's not really as much of how much or how little you have, but that blessing really truly comes from the Lord. And in stewardship, that's a good reminder, because it's not about how much we have, but how we can give to the Lord what we do have. So just wanted to share that. And so with that said, that's all the announcements I have. So let us rise and stand. And as we do stand, we do worship, and we don't worship just in any name, but we worship in our triune God's name, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so as we did stand up, we get to sing out, "Stand up and bless the Lord."
The Lord your our strength and song, and his salvation ours. Then be his love in Christ proclaimed with all our ransom powers. Stand up and bless the Lord, the Lord your God adore. Stand up and bless his glorious name, henceforth forevermore.
And O Lord, as we do stand up and bless you, we thank you for this day, O breath of life, and pray that you would open our eyes to see beyond our trials so that we can continuously glorify you in all situations of life. Increase our trust in you, and let us always remember that you will never walk out on us. And then give us grace to live our lives in a way that our trials will not draw us away from you, but draw us closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. There are times, though, where we are drawn away from the Lord, and in those moments we fall into sin, and so we have to confess that, and that's what we do now. Loving and merciful Father, when overcome by grief, with Job, we wonder what happened to your love and your wonderful plan for our lives. It feels as though our prayers fall on deaf ears. Like Job, we begin looking for you to the east, to the west, to the north, and to the south. All the four points of the horizon and the compass. But you are nowhere to be found. The darkness threatens to swallow us whole, and we feel as though we are drowning in the ocean of divine silence. Lord, then we are tempted to do something cheap or dirty, something that will bring great shame upon us and those we love. Have mercy on us, and forgive us, O God, for those times we sin. So take a few moments of silence and just ask the Lord to forgive you for those times that you do sin, like we just confessed. Hear the word of the Lord from Job 42:12. The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the first. And hearing that, we are reminded that our God turns crucifixion into resurrections. What was dead is now alive, and what was defeat is now an everlasting triumph. Christ is alive, and he forgives you all your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. And as forgiven people, you now may be seated as we hear our word of the Lord from this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading this morning is from the book of Job. It will be the sermon text. It's Job 42, 1 through 6 and 10 through 17. Then Job replied to the Lord, "I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You ask, 'Who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge?' Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, 'Listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me.' My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." After Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes and gave him twice as much as he had before. All his brothers and sisters and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in his house. They comforted and consoled him over all the troubles the Lord had brought on him, and each one gave him a piece of silver and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the former part. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. The first daughter he named Jemima, the second Keziah, and the third Karen Hapuk. Nowhere in all the land were there found women as beautiful as Job's daughters, and their father granted them an inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children and their children to the fourth generation. And so Job died, an old man and full of years. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is Psalm 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nation, "The Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy." Restore our fortunes, Lord, like streams in the Negev. Then those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them. This is the word of the Lord.
Please stand for the gospel reading. Gospel reading is from Mark 10, 46 through 52. Then they came to Jericho, as Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city. A blind man, Bartimaeus, which means the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called him to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet. He's calling you," throwing his cloak aside. He jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. And just like the blind man was given his sight day by day, we see the mercies of the Lord anew, and so that's how we can confess the goodness of God with the Apostles' Creed. So we do that now. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now may be seated as we continue to worship. And the sermon hymn we're singing is a tune that will be familiar to everyone. The words are ones that might be new, but they fit very well about the way God moves, especially in Job's life. And so we sing, God moves in a mysterious way. Start with a word of prayer. Lord, we do thank you that in the midst of you moving in mysterious ways, that you do ride upon the storm. As we see the rain clouds above us, even this very moment, and clouds can fill us with so much dread, may we always be reminded that in the midst of these, you are big with mercy and will break in blessings on our heads. So we ask that you bless us this day, that you would open our eyes to your love, your mercy, your gospel. Guide the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts, that they be pleasing to you and you alone, that we would see only you in this place, that you would remove any temptation or distraction that would try to come up against us, whether here or in our homes. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Born to trouble. Born to Trouble, that's the name of our series. And it seemingly is also what we have seen throughout Job's life. There has been trouble, there has been pain, anguish, grief, and we have sat on the ash heap with him. And we have seen God respond with majesty and also personally, as I am. And now as we reach the end, and as Dale read about all the various blessings Job received, it seems like it's just happily ever after, and then Job lived happily ever after. Is that really the case, though? Is it really possible that the Bible's most troubled and at times most torturous book has the proverbial happy ending? It's like Walt Disney got a hold of the last chapter and decided to write it out. Is that really what happens, though, in life? We might think so maybe at times, but we'll see there's more going on here. That's what we're going to get into with the rest of our lesson. And before we get to the actual restoration of Job and all those blessings, we see him give a fleshed out response to the words of Yahweh. We looked at those last week through chapters 38 through 41. And in verse 3 of Job's response, he echoes the words and the question, the challenge of what God asked him, what he challenged him with. And Job says this in verse 3, speaking to God, "You asked, who is it that obscures my plans without knowledge?" And then Job responds to the question, says, Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. Here Job clearly and explicitly admits that he did what God had questioned him about, what God had accused him of, that he did speak of things he did not understand. Job admits there's things he shouldn't have said. And it's only after he heard God's word to him that he understood this. And so this reminds us of a first important point that comes out of this lesson, this reading, is that before being restored, he confesses. He confesses where he has gone wrong before the Lord. And then as we move on, we see, and Job speaks to why it is he confesses, what has caused this, as he says in verse 5, my ears have heard about you, but now my eyes have seen you. We might read this verse in light of his friends, who we skip over in the lectionary, but are talked about in this section as well. And God chastises them that they spoke wrong. They gave lots of advice about God, but they don't truly see him. So too, Job lived this type of life. One point he heard there was a God Almighty. He had heard he was righteous and all powerful, and he might have heard that if you did all the right things before this God, you would be blessed. But then his life shook that understanding. It basically shook it apart. And it's only when he encounters the images that God paints for him, the images of what God has done in creation and overcoming evil in chapters 38 through 41, he sees the Lord. He sees the Lord in these images and he confesses. And as he confesses, the next step we see is it causes him to repent. And this pattern should impact our lives then as well. When we see the Lord, when he is revealed to us, it should cause us to have confession and repentance. This is a continual thing of life. When we see him in the sacraments, when we see him in the living word, when we see the Holy Spirit causing a new vision amongst us, one of forgiving as I am has forgiven us, one of caring for others as the Lord has cared for us. It's in those moments that I am washes over us, and it's in this cleansing that we and Job are truly blessed. This is the greatest blessing in the midst of all of what Job receives, that he is forgiven by I am. And then this leads us into the very last words of the book of Job. We get to that happily ever after, if you will, or maybe we're questioning if it is, but like I said, it's really not that simple, and let me tell you why. Let me share with you, I want to share another verse that parallels what Job has gone through. If you remember our series before Job, we were in the book of James, and he was encouraging believers to persevere. And it's interesting to see who he points to as an example of perseverance. So let me read to you James 5:11. Once again, this is James 5:11. "As you know, we count as blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance, and have seen what the Lord has finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. So if James points to Job's perseverance, what can we say about Job's perseverance? Well, in Job's perseverance, we see there's spiritual warfare. He perseveres in spiritual warfare. There's a monster, we see it throughout the book of Job, that tears at his life. Satan fills his mind with struggles, with images of despair, darkness, and death. Job is taken through the valley of the shadow of death, literally, as his loved ones are ripped away from him, and he endures all of this because he fears God. And he doesn't lose his faith. I have a question for you then. Who is this dark warfare fulfilled in? It is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Jesus is the blameless believer. Looking through the gospel, we see that Satan attacks Jesus with even more ferocity than he does even Job. Satan tears at Jesus' soul by temptation, by discouragement, by misunderstanding, ultimately soul, mind, and body on the cross. Job is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And here's an important reminder about spiritual warfare. Often we see ourselves as the main ones fighting. Like we're the champion fighter, that we're resisting the battle, that we're the ones who have to do all the action. But that's actually wrong. We're not that. You know what we are? We're the battlefield. And what I mean is that on our own, we cannot fight the battle. We are not equipped. Every time we try to fight, we fall back into our old ways, into sin. And so when we talk about spiritual warfare, we have to look to the champion who fights for us, the champion who wins the day, as we will look at next week, the mighty fortress who is our God, who wins the battle. We are the ones who are being fought over. We are the battlefield between Satan and Yahweh. And the good news is that Jesus has won the battle. It's not the stuff that Job receives that restores him to happily ever after. Ultimately, what restores him is that one day his Savior will win the battle through his crucifixion and resurrection. That victory is just as much for Job as it is for us. And that is what truly gives him a happily ever after. And we see this within the actual blessings of Job. Not to say that that stuff isn't important. You see, the Lord gives Job, he gives him far greater blessings than what he even originally had. And what we see is this is actually a foreshadowing, because where else do we see greater blessings than what one originally had? We see it foreshadowed when Judah returns from exile. And it ultimately foreshadows the resurrection, the ascension, and the heavenly reign of Jesus Christ. God gives Job renewed celebration and joy in his blessings. And what it's also worth noting is that when is it that Job declares that he has seen the Lord? It's before all of those material things are restored. He worships God not because of the stuff he has been given, not because of what he might or might not get from him, but because God is God. And this is a good reminder for us. We're also reminded of something else in the blessing, is that Job receives double of what he had before, and it's an undeserved blessing. You know, if God was to make it fair and equal, he would have just given him the same amount right back. But he deposits double down for him. And what is an undeserved blessing called? It's grace. Yeah, that's grace. God is pouring grace out upon Job. And we can see how he pours this grace out upon us. We have to remind that the normal Christian life is warfare. We are the battlefield, and there's going to be continual fighting going on, but we are also completely loved and justified by the Lord, who is full of that compassion and mercy, as we read in James. And the blessings of life that we receive now, they're just a tiny foretaste of the feast that is to come, of the blessings we will get in the end when we're reunited with our Savior. Amen. But let's not just gloss over Job and his life, because we see it's not just a happily ever after, even in that section of all of the blessings that he receives. We read this in verse 11. It's on the screens. And this is speaking to his brothers and sisters who return after all of this. They were absent during it. I don't know why. But it says they comforted and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought on him. That's an important reminder that even with all of this stuff, all sons and all these other sons and daughters he receives, all the material stuff, Job didn't get the perfect happy ending. He wasn't truly born to trouble, because like it says, that the Lord had brought it upon him, but he still needed comfort. He still needed consolation in the midst of his troubles, even in this time period. The memories of what Job had happened to him, they wouldn't have just faded away, because now he just had received all of these things. He most likely had what we modernly would understand as PTSD. He needed continued care. He needed continued support and a listening ear, even after all of this. After all, since he had been told the original reasons behind this catastrophe were beyond his understanding, he was never given a reason for it. So who was to say that it couldn't happen again, that God could take all of what he had just received back again? And if that did happen, wouldn't there have been just as much mystery as there had been the first time? And so you'd hardly be surprised if somehow we found out in Job's life that after his prosperity returned, that he stayed jumpy, anxious, afraid, and even had times of depression. Dark clouds coming his direction probably made him still want to make sure his children were safe with him instead of at another house. And loud noises probably startled him more than they used to. Every once in a while, his wife and kids could probably see a distant look in Job's eyes, and they knew he was wondering about all that had happened all over again. So many of us have those same type of questions, don't we? The big questions, they never truly go away. Not even for us dear saints who can point to the goodness and mercy of the Lord, who have the comfort of the Holy Spirit in our lives and faith in Jesus Christ. Even we wish we could change the past or the present. So we too need a friend, a shoulder, a family member to comfort and to console us. And then for all of us here, we find the ultimate comfort and consolation in our Lord Jesus Christ. What a friend we have in Jesus, who our eyes now see. And what a powerful reminder of the glory of God in the moment when Job declares that he has seen the Lord. And what's even more amazing is that Job prophesied this moment. He did see the Lord. He proclaimed it, but he also said he would see the Lord. I want to share with you some words, and we're going back into Job. I didn't cover them at the time because I wanted to go over them when they were actually fulfilled. And these words are from Job 19, 25 through 27. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another, how my heart yearns within me. That's right, Job had faith that he would see the Lord, even in the midst of the troubles, even on the ash heap. He held firm that he would see the Lord. And we also know that those words, "For I know that my Redeemer lives," become the opening words to one of our most beloved Easter resurrection hymns. And what a powerful reminder to close our series on, that this is our true happily ever after, that we know our Redeemer lives. And it's good reminder that Job speaks, not his Redeemer lives, not her Redeemer, not their Redeemer or your Redeemer, but my Redeemer. It's personal, it's intimate and individual. It's my Redeemer. And in the Old Testament, a Redeemer was one who made things right. A Redeemer was one who made things right. Whatever goes bad, your Redeemer would make good. What was broken would be mended. What was sick would be healed, as we saw with the blind man in the gospel lesson. Whatever was lost would be restored, and whatever dead was made alive. And that's the faith that Job holds to, as he says in verse 26, like I just read, "And after my skin is destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God." He's talking about resurrection here. And then he says, I know my Redeemer, and we know our Redeemer. My Redeemer is who? Jesus. Jesus is not a mystical, abstract, impersonal, vague idea. Jesus is a man who came in the flesh, but was also fully God, and his strong hand is guiding us, and his tender heart is loving us right now, whatever we face down the long, hard journeys of life, when the hallways seem dark, when the clouds seem dark. As our Redeemer, Jesus comes not only to see that justice is done, but that mercy is given. Jesus bears whatever needs to be borne and carries whatever needs to be carried in order to see that our wrongs are righted. And if a sentence needs to be served, he serves the sentence. If a fine needs to be paid, he pays the fine. He does whatever it takes to set us free, even if it means his life for ours. Rejoice, because Jesus forgives my guilt, and he is living and destroys our graves forever. I know that my Redeemer lives. Job knows that. Even in the midst of trouble, he will see the Lord. And the happily ever after is this, that not only will he see the Lord, but he can proclaim the same thing that we proclaim today. I know that my Redeemer lives. Jesus lives today. Amen. Our Redeemer, Jesus, is alive. And now we stand at the top of the world, and we can see everything that has happened, that death is dead, that the grave has been defeated, that the free gift of eternal life is absolutely ours forever and ever and ever. And there's a word for all this. We talked about that word earlier. What's that word? Grace. Grace is the amazing gift that God gives to us, the happily ever after, that when all is wrong around us, even in the very core of our lives, when everything is going haywire, it's all right because God has grace for us. Grace is the gift of power, the power to be freed, to be the person God wants us to be. Grace is the promise that on the days we can barely cope or carry on in circumstances, that he will be there with us and for us, and that in faith tomorrow will be better in him. Maybe not on the calendar, but the ultimate tomorrow when we come home to him. Grace is the love poured out upon us, that all our debts are paid, that we are released from the slavery of sin, and that our brokenness is repaired. That's grace. What does it all mean? It means no matter the dark hallway you are walking at now, whatever the giants, the beasts are saying and tempting you with right now, you do not walk alone. And why is that? He lives, all glory, to his name. He lives, my Jesus, still the same. Oh, the sweet joy this sentence gives. I know that my Redeemer lives. Amen and alleluia. Now your eyes have seen the Redeemer. Share what your eyes have seen. And let's make that our prayer. Oh God, for our redemption, you gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of the enemy. Grant that all our sin may be drowned daily through repentance and confession, and that day by day we may arise to see you, and then go forth to live before you in righteousness and purity forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. All God's people said, Amen. Amen indeed. And so at this time, we'll take a few moments to reflect, and may your eyes just see the Lord in this instrumental music as we do that. And then we'll get into a time of worship, and we'll begin with the old praise song, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord, as that's really what our theme is today. Then we'll go into the rest of praise. And once again, thank you so much for your support of the Ministry of Resurrection. We appreciate it so much, and just pray blessings over everyone. As you go forward, may you go forth with your Redeemer who lives. Alleluia. Alleluia. So let's listen to some music, then we'll get into worship. Let us all rise and stand and ask the Lord to open our eyes.
Yesterday I watched a little boy, I must have been about 6 or 7, singing, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord. This little boy was autistic and he was blind. And as he sang that song, it made me feel like, why don't I open my heart better to the Lord? So as you sing this song, Open the Eyes of My Heart, think about how the Lord can really open our eyes so we can see Him.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Oh, Lord, we do want to see you. So open our eyes. Because, Lord, you are the good, good Father. Sent your Son into this world to pay for our sins. What a good, good Father you are.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night. You tell me that you're pleased and that I never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, you're perfect in all of your ways, you are perfect in all. Unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are.
About grace this morning, and what a marvelous grace the Lord has for us. I mean, how many of us could send our sons to be crucified on a cross? But we got a God that created everything, the one to save us, and so he had to give up his Son. So what an amazing grace our Lord has for us.
Amazing praise. How sweet the sound to save a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope. My shield and horse as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a
thank you indeed, Jesus. You are forever ours. You are the one who opens our eyes to your goodness and mercy day by day and your amazing grace. We thank you so much for that. So we lift that up and we'll come into our time of prayer. So you can go into whatever posture prayer is best for you now. If you do need to take a seat, it's totally fine. And for those of you at home, can lift up any of the prayers you have on your hearts and type those out. And so let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. And we praise you that you are our God of life, that you are living and resurrected, that you open our eyes on the world you love and show us your presence and purpose all around us. We see the beauty and wonder of your creation in autumn changes and in the gifts of love and compassion offered through friend and stranger. For these many gifts, we give you thanks. And we pray as you open our eyes to your love day by day, that we may share this same love and open other people's eyes to this very love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we give praise for this day and every single day, that they may be holy, good, and joyful, that we may offer to you our worship and our work, and that we may strive for the well-being of all creation, and that in the pleasures and pains of life, we know the love of Christ through all things and can be thankful. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we thank you for the brave, wise, and good among us who risk so much to protect life, health, liberty, and justice, especially as we think of our first responders, our military, and those who work in healthcare. Renew and sustain their strength and resolve. Use them to mend communities fractured by sickness, violence, and injustice, and to lead many along to your way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we ask that you would bless your whole church, not just here, not just in our community or in our country, but around the world, that she may shine your Son's light in this world. Revive and refresh us by your Holy Spirit so we can confess your name before others, that we can pray fervently for our neighbor and demonstrate your love through good works. And as we think about that, we lift up to our dear friends at Lighthouse Family Ministry Northwest as they have their celebration event today at 3 p.m. Just pray that it would be a glory to you, that your love would be revealed, that your gospel hope would be shared. And just pray over the final time of their online auction that this could just be another way to glorify you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we pray for those whose eyes don't see you. We pray for those who cannot recognize and see the gifts of your gospel in their lives and find themselves lost and alone. There's many of those people we know in our hearts. We'd ask that you open their eyes to your presence through our companionship, and that you would give our eyes, open our eyes for opportunities to reach out with understanding to them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And God of justice, you open our eyes on the world and show us struggle and conflict. We see the stressful times in which we live and the burdens that many are carrying. And so today we pray for those burdens. We pray for those whose businesses are still struggling as the pandemic stretches on. We pray for producers, for farmers unsure their harvest will be sufficient this season. We pray for workers uncertain about their jobs or looking for new work. And we pray for families carrying the stress of economic uncertainty, and pray your blessings of security and peace upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In God of wisdom, you open our eyes on the world and show us its complexities. We see countries and people locked in old animosities and communities overwhelmed by anger and upheaval. We pray for the millions displaced by current conflicts and natural disasters. And we pray for leaders everywhere trying to find solutions to complex problems. Open the eyes of those who lead to recognize the suffering among their people, and open their eyes and our ways to the best way we can participate in solutions and look to you for wisdom and guidance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we ask that Jesus would bring healing and encouragement to all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. And so, Lord, we lift up all those who are in need of healing in our midst, in our community of the church here, and also our larger community. We'd ask that you bring them healing and hope, and bring them, more importantly, your light in your life, your gospel. Refresh all who care for them as well, so that together they may walk along your way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And at this time, lift up now any of the prayers or praises on your hearts.
Join me in bringing paper bags, food, and clothes to the church here.
Hear our prayer. Hear our prayer. Hear our prayer.
Lord, I thank you for the healing of my wife. That's sometimes taking away the medicine is what is required. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear our prayer. Lord, we lift up to you all these prayers spoken, all those unspoken, whether they're here in our sanctuary, in our homes. We know that you hear all these prayers. No time or distance can separate us from your love, from your hearing ear, and from you being able to see us and us seeing you. And with our eyes now opened, let us pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And with your eyes open in the Lord, going forth in the name of the great I am, go forth to declare, I know that my Redeemer lives. And as you go forth to do that, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. And the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Amen. Let us now sing out to the everlasting God.
We draw, Lord, all our strength from you, the one true and everlasting God. You are our only hope. And you are our only deliverer.
Strength arises we made upon the Lord, we were made upon the Lord, we were made upon the Lord. Strength arises we made upon the Lord, we were made upon the Lord, we were made upon the Lord. Our God, you remain forever. Thank you.
Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.